exactly 365 days. So, in honor of the leap year that we celebrate this month, I'd like to share with you a true story about an old wedding anniversary celebrated on February the 29th, 1982. It's about my maternal grandparents. They were married on February the 28th, 1932, at St. Mary's Church in Grayson, Saskatchewan. Anyways, I can still remember how happy they were at their 50th wedding anniversary. And they were really happy gathering with their family, their children. They had had four children, but one had died in childbirth. Their spouses, my parents, and their grandchildren, me and the others. They knew something about each and every one of us, but I suspect that their knowledge about us was somewhat different than our knowledge about them. Time had not always been very kind to them. But I remember them saying some very truthful and beautiful things about each other. They were embarrassed to talk about themselves and when they were first married. But I remember their love for each other. It wasn't superficial. They would have celebrated their 70th wedding anniversary in 2002, but my grandfather died 2 months prior. This was a lifetime transfiguration of love. They had many periods of uncertainty and anxiety in their lives. They lived through the Great Depression and poverty in the 1930s and the uncertain outcome of the Second World War. There was also an ongoing struggle of poverty on the Canadian prairies, which always threatened to overwhelm them. However, in 1982, there was an abiding sense of joy of their life surrounded by their family. This moment in my family's extended family was kind of a moment for us. It was a time when, just a brief moment, we saw a very ordinary event in an extraordinary kind of way. It was a moment when God seemed to shine through the world and everything around us. We kind of got a glimpse of the other world beyond. That's why the church places these readings amongst the somber ones of Lent. The church wants to give you and me kind of a boost before turning our attention to the suffering of Jesus on Good Friday. Gives us something to hold on to as we re-encounter and remember Jesus' Good Friday, his painful death, and his suffering on the cross. If you do the Stations of the Cross like we did, we do on every Friday of Lent, we start over here and we make our way around. The last one is Jesus' body is taken down and placed in the tomb. But we conclude when we come in front of the altar and remember that Jesus, not just his life and his death are celebrated at the altar, but we remember his resurrection here as well. The other reason for these readings being right in the middle of Lent is that the Transfiguration is closely related to Jesus' agony at the garden. And both these events, they take place on a mountain. The agony of the garden takes place at the Mount of Olives, and his Transfiguration on Mount Tabor. These could be moments of confusion in their encounter with God. Think of Abraham in the first reading from Genesis. St. Paul echoes this in the second reading. That Abraham's encounter with God takes place on a mountain here in the first reading. Do you think Abraham was slightly confused about what God was asking him to do? Sacrifice his son, his only son, who was the promise of his inheritance? Abraham is imitating what God did. God allowed his son to sacrifice for a reason. That's not the end of the story. That's what you and I, as Catholics, as Christians, we believe that. Well, that's not the end of the story. And yet, Abraham trusted God. The guy was over 100 years old. His son was born when he was like 100. Isaac, he could talk and chat and say, well, where's the sacrifice, Dad? Well, God will provide then. God did provide, but God wanted to test to see if Abraham had faith in God's word, that God knew what God was doing. And there's beauty in that incredible trust and that ancient faith. Incredible beauty. Beauty in the whole idea of sacrificing a child or sacrificing, you know, somebody. It's not that. It's about the trust. God would not allow Abraham to do something so horrific. But God allowed himself to do something that horrific. It's on Mount Tabor. The disciples saw Jesus in a moment of beauty when his divinity shone through. On the Mount of Olives, the disciples also saw Jesus in a moment of agony when his humanity shone through. And these are the two sides of the same coin, Jesus' humanity and his divinity. Only God could allow that to happen such that it would save the human race. Sin. And this is where the message becomes really, really important for you and for me. Like Jesus, every one of us has a twofold dimension to our lives. In each one of us, there's a spark of Adam and Eve of sin. And there's also a spark of God. We experience moments of beauty where the spark of God shines through so brightly it almost blinds us. During these moments, we feel very close to God. On the other hand, like Jesus on the Mount of Olives, we can also experience great moments of agony. When the sin of Adam and Eve surfaces so sharply, that original sin, that spark of God almost seems extinguished. We feel really far from God, and we wonder, does God even exist? When these moments of agony and ecstasy come, remember these two mountain moments, Mount Tabor and the Mount of Olives. Jesus experienced these highs and these lows. Also, remember what Jesus did during these moments. He prayed. The season of Lent is a time to renew our prayer. And if we do respond in prayer, then just like Jesus during the Transfiguration, we too will hear God say to us what the Father said to Jesus. You are my beloved. Listen to my son. And if we do listen, if we do respond in prayer like Jesus did in his agony,